Hey, this is Lenny Williams. Why don't you come on and join us right now? Yeah.
And welcome everyone to another edition of Stories of Music. I'm your host, Les Holmes, and I thank you so much for joining me. And before we get to our guest, I want to say give a shout out to my sponsor, and it is Dare to Be Different 601. That's Dare to Be Different 601. So get an opportunity to go over to IG and check them out. And also my queen, Miriam Nubian Queen Graham over at Never Stop Entertainment. Thank you so much for your support. And now to our guest. It's his second trip this way, and I'm so grateful that he's able to drop in on us. He's done a little work around the world. He's been with us. He's worked with some groups like Sly Stone, Andre Crouch. He's hung out with Billy Preston, the Hawkins family, Walter and Tremaine, and all those. And you may have heard of him. He had this song out back in the day. It's called "Cause I Love You." Ladies and gentlemen, no one other than Mr. Lenny Williams. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us again.
My pleasure, Les. Glad to be here. Yes, most definitely.
Man, we had a real good conversation. Matter of fact, it was almost a year ago. I'm sure it was a year ago that we've talked. And now you're back. And when we last talked, I'm going to say the world was still on the sick and shut in list. Everybody was kind of
most definitely right. Yes,
kind of shut down, and we were all confined, and you know, kind of scared to move around. So now that things have opened back up, so how have things been for you, Lenny?
Well, I've been really, really busy. It seems like every weekend I'm working somewhere. I guess, you know, people been, like you say, been sick and shut in and shut off. And now that, you know, people are getting a chance to get out, they want entertainment. They want to get out and socialize. And so me and most of my friends that are in the business, we've been working quite a bit. You know, people want to get out and dance, see each other and have a good time. So the calendar is full.
Okay, that's a good thing. So how you feeling about that? I know you're glad to be out. Mm-hmm. And I know you're glad to be out, you know, making your money and earning your living and stuff. So, but how are you in regards to just being out and engaging with the public?
Well, at first there was some trepidation, you know, because I don't want to get sick and you know, come back home and make my wife sick. And so, you know, I just try to be cautious, you know, taking all the precautions, you know, getting the booster shots and doing that. And, you know, wearing, you know, the right prophylactics, you know, gloves and things mm-hmm. like that and masks. But I was telling my wife, went to Cincinnati and to Maryland this weekend. I said, I'm seeing less and less masks, you know, and, you know, people, you know, are starting to feel comfortable, I guess, maybe because of the fact that the numbers are going down and a lot of people have been getting the vaccines and mm-hmm. getting the boosters and things of that nature. So it's a good sign, and I hopefully that it just keeps on. You know, I see that where President Biden said that the pandemic is over, and so some people think that was kind of premature mm-hmm. For him to say that. But you know, I think we're getting pretty close to, you know, being able to say that it's over. And but I think the people, winter's coming, and people should still, you know, be cautious. Yeah. And I'm trying to do the same.
Yeah, and speaking of being a little bit. I say premature, mm-hmm. And they're saying it's over. But I think his timing is a little bit better than the president before him.
Oh, most definitely, right?
Because,
yes,
because he said it was going to be over by Easter.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I think his calculation was a little off. Like something like me in math class, right? Yeah, I think this is the answer. No. Yeah.
So what cities have that you've noticed that you've been in since the pandemic and you've been back out there? What has been one of your most interactive cities where you just really felt a lot of love?
Well, it's just interesting. I mean, it's all over the place. I mean, you know, just kind of like a consensus that people are, you know, I'm trying to look at my calendar here to think of all the cities that I've been in. But, you know, anywhere you get down south of, you know, across that Mason-Dixon line, you know, people are just generally friendly anyway. And so, you know, you see the party atmosphere, good food and things of that nature. But I was in Cincinnati this past weekend. It was beautiful, you know, and like I was up in Bethesda, Maryland, and, you know, close to Chocolate City, and, and people come out and, they got on their nice clothes and they're having a good time. And so I would say that generally, you know, I mean, I could pick those two, but, you know, I've been, you know, down in Mississippi, you know, Jackson and places like that. And the people, you know, come out. I'm down in Greenwood, Mississippi, Greenville, Mississippi, you know, so, it just seems like the people all over are, you know, they're ready for some good times and to, you know, put the pandemic and all the fear behind them and come on out and be productive.
Mm-hmm. Well, man, I'm glad things have opened up, and I've been a couple of places and enjoyed some shows, and it's been fun. And, you know, like you, I've watched the people in the non-mask, and you know, I had to get used to that. So but you know, we're slowly but surely getting back into the groove of things. So I want to take you somewhere real quick.
Okay.
Since you've been here before, I think I know you a little bit now. So
yes, sir. Yeah.
So your song, 'Cause I Love You.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I've heard that song by so many people, and that is like your anthem. That's your song.
Oh, so, I gotta sing that. Yes.
Yeah, I want you to check out. They say imitation is the biggest form of flattery.
Mm-hmm.
So I want you. You may have heard of this young man, but I want you to tell me, he's the only one, I'm being totally honest, he's the only one that I think actually does your song justice. So I want you to check this young man out, mm-hmm. and tell me what you think about him.
Is that Jeffrey?
No, that's not Jeffrey. Okay. No, sir. Okay. Not Jeffrey.
Okay.
Lots of women, for the pleasures of feel, but I only want your girl, if it's in God's will, cause I love.
He's that acapella, right? Yeah, he had the chords in his head, all the changes. Yeah, that's awesome. Hey, old to be young again, right? Yeah.
His name is Avery Wilson.
Uh-huh.
And I ran across him a couple of days ago, and I was like, whoa, okay.
Yeah, well, Avery doing it. Uh-huh. Yeah, I still hit the notes, but I got a ladder that I climb up on to get the nuts. Yeah, I can climb up on that now. Yeah. I bet he could just sit down in the chair and hit that note.
He probably can. Mm-hmm. He probably can. Would you say old to be young again? Huh?
Old to be young again, yes.
So talk to me, Mr. Williams. What you've been working on? I know you've got a new single, so talk to us about your new single.
Yeah, I was doing some work with Preston Glass. You know, he's a very prolific songwriter, wrote for Aretha Franklin, Whitney Houston, mm-hmm. Just so many different people, and Kenny G.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was doing some mentoring of a young man out of Birmingham, Alabama,
mm-hmm.
and told me he wanted me to meet him. And so we met, and he's a songwriter as well. And he was introducing me to some of the music that he was working on. And he showed me a particular song, and I just fell right in love with it. And he allowed me to do a little writing with him,
uh-huh.
although he did the majority of the writing. And so we went in the studio, and Brandon Watts is his name, And we went in the studio and recorded it. And everybody was like, oh, man, this song is great. It's great, great. And working on an album. And everybody said, man, go put that song on out right now. So I just kind of like, you know, followed the consensus and bam, you know. And getting some good response.
So it's weekend. I mean, weekday blues.
Weekday blues, right?
Weekday yes. blues. Weekday yes. blues. There it is right there, on the screen. So I took a listen to it, and I like that. I yes. like it. It takes me back to when I was a younger uh-huh. younger man.
Yes,
or just becoming a young man.
Yes.
And it reminded me of Friday night
mm-hmm.
and getting ready to go take my girlfriend out and we were going to have a nice time. You know, I didn't do any drinking or nothing back then. Uh-huh. We just going to go out and go to the picture show.
Right, yeah. Exactly, right. Yeah, it was just basically a song about, you know, working hard all week. Uh-huh. And, you know, and then on the week, you know, you have your weekday blues, whatever that might be, you know, traffic jams and, yeah. you know, getting along with the boss, your coworkers, and then, you know, it's the weekend and it's time to, you know, wash up the car and put on something nice and, you know, take your girl out. Yes. Have a good time.
That's it. So tell me, Lenny, it's going to sound like a crazy question. But what does music do for you?
Well, I think music fulfills me because they say the music soothes the savage beast. You mm-hmm. know, I've heard that expression quite a bit in my life. And, you know, all of us have, you know, whatever our beast may be, it could be anxiety, depression, mm-hmm. or it could be that we're compulsive and, you know, we've always got to be, you know, tinkering around, and music can just kind of just slow you down and just get you in a relaxed mood, or can get you in a joyous mood, you know, or a mood that, you know, life of the party kind of mood, you know, so whatever mm-hmm. that it is that you need, you know, music can, you know, can be kind of like a balm in Gilead, you know, so to speak, you know, just heal whatever needs to be healed.
Yeah. Well, you know, David, he played the harp for the king. So the king called him up when he was upset. He said, get my boy in here. Yeah. I need some music.
Exactly. Right. Yeah.
Calm me down.
Exactly. And then even like in the Bible, well, the Levites, you know, were the musicians. And mm-hmm. I think that's when they would raise what we call tithes today, that 10% was basically for the musicians. They were an essential part of worship and, you know, keeping the people, you know, content and, mm-hmm. and happy. Yeah. So, mm-hmm. so music is very, very important. You know, a lot of schools use it as music therapy. In the halls of a lot of psychology schools now, you know, they're incorporating music as a therapy, especially with the young people. And then even with the older people, you know, who are experiencing dementia, things of that nature.
Right.
That music is essential to helping them cope.
Right. Matter of fact, you mentioned that. I was looking at a young man on one of these shows on the competition singing mm-hmm. show. And he was saying he wrote a song for his mother
mm-hmm.
who had dementia. She since passed, but he wrote the song for her. And when he was singing that song, it was like she would come back in to focus and realize who he was.
Right.
So music does do it's amazing how music does that for you. I mean, somebody can talk to you all day long. Daddy, you remember me? Mama, you remember me? You remember me? Mm-hmm. You remember me? But some music come on and that brings them right back.
Those toes get to tapping.
So name me somebody that we don't know about.
Mm-hmm.
That we should look out for, that some new cat coming up, you know, young lady coming up or young guy coming up, somebody that you think we'll be paying attention to in the future.
young man that I happen to write this song with, Brandon Watts.
Okay.
Somebody to look up. Yeah, he spells it W-A-T-T-Z, Brandon Watts. Just the all around, kind of like a Sammy Davis Jr. type. You know, he can sing anything from, Fly Me to the Moon to James Brown, Get On Up. Yeah, right. Yeah. Everything in between.
So Brandon Watts.
Brandon Watts, yes. Most
definitely. We need to check out Brandon Watts and see what Mr. Watts got going on. So we know he's a good writer. So let's check him out and see what he's got going on.
Great singer as well.
Okay. All right. And somebody that you would like to perform with that you haven't performed with.
Let's see. I'd say Beyonce would probably be somebody. Yeah.
And it's not out of reach because she just did a song with Ronald Isley.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So absolutely. And Beyonce.
I grew up with her stepfather, Richard Lawson, too, right? Yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, which is interesting. I say he was on, I think it was Dynasty or Dallas or something way back in the day.
Yeah.
And I thought he was the man when I saw him kiss Diane Carroll. I said, oh, my God, this boy done kissed Diane Carroll. And then now it's like, 30 years later, he's married to her mom.
Right.
Another beautiful woman. And I said, Richard, I drank the same water Richard drank, I don't know what. But I do have a beautiful wife, yes.
I was going to say, be careful now. Because
yeah, be careful, right, yes, right, yes. Yes, I do have a beautiful wife.
So, so here we go. Here we go, since you say Beyonce. So would you want to do one of your songs with her? Would you like for her to do that? Or would you like to collab with her on something totally new?
Yeah, probably something totally new because she's young and young people are very innovative and so she seems like she always has an ear for something new, something exciting, something that touches a mass of people. And I think that's what you want to do. If you got a sermon or you've got a speech or you invent something, you want it to, be for the masses. You don't want to put it over in the corner. And so, so I think that that would be good. Yeah. So, yeah, definitely. But I'd go with whatever she wanted to go with, but I would think something new and exciting. Yeah. Would be the way to go. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So those of you in the Beehive, if you're looking, and those of you who are very connected to Beyonce, you heard it right here on Stories of Music. Mr. Lenny Williams, Beyonce, he's waiting on that call.
Yeah, her husband, Jay-Z, sampled one of my songs. So, then we just make it a whole family thing, get Beyonce there. And it's like, okay, cool. We got the whole family there. Well, the whole head.
Yeah, yeah.
Their family, yes.
Yeah, yeah. So it's already done. So you're already in the door. So you good.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the door a little bit right there. Yes.
Let me flip that. They're already in the door. How about that?
Well, we could say that. Right? I think I'm more in that door than they're in mine. That's for sure. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, here's one of my last questions for you. You may have to think about this a little bit. So what is something about Lenny Williams that hardly anybody knows?
Well, I guess most people wouldn't know unless they grew up in Oakland that I was a teenage preacher.
Okay.
And I was about maybe 16, and I take my Bible to school every day. I remember some of the girls used to tell me, "Ooh, look, girlie, he got his Bible." And they'd come up, we changed classes in high school, and this one girl, she'd see me start doing the holy dance and everything, and I didn't realize it. Then, but I realized that now she probably liked me, But,
Yeah.
But I had done, so I was a teenage preacher for quite a few years. And then I started going to college. And then I started going to college with Huey Newton and Bobby Seale. Mm-hmm. And I was with them when they first announced the idea to start the Black Panther Party. And then it was the turbulent 60s, and you know, had kind of grown up, you know, my dad kind of leaning toward Martin Luther King's philosophy, and then me being younger and growing up in Oakland, started listening to people like Stokely Carmichael and Rap Brown, and of course Huey Newton and Bobby Seale, taking a more militant approach, and then started to kind of put Christianity on a scale. It's like, and you know, and examine it, you know, or dissect it, and couldn't come to grips with the fact that, you know, my tormentors or the people that wanted to hang me or hang us or to enslave us or thought we were subhuman, professed Christianity. And it's like, well, how could that be? And so I walked away from Christianity for quite a few years. Mm-hmm. And thank God for his grace and understanding, you know, when this came to my senses, you know, he opened, with open arms accepted me back. But that's something that I think that most people don't know about me. Right? Like I said, I grew up in church, you know, with the Hawkins family, Walton, mm-hmm. Ed, Sly Stone's family, the Stewart family, Billy Preston, all those people. And, we sang and I preached and we just had a good time. Yeah, yeah.
So now when... I said that was my last question, but you kind of opened up Pandora's box. So how did you feel? This is out there. How did you feel when Dr. King got assassinated? Did that have, I'm not saying you're supposed to cheer or nothing like that. I'm just saying that your dad was on the side of Martin. You on the side of the Black Panthers, Stokely and all those. Mm-hmm. So what were your thoughts when that happened? What did you think at that point when he was assassinated?
I mean, I was very, very sad. I mean, I admired Dr. Martin Luther King. My dad took me to hear him speak at the Oakland Auditorium when I was young. Okay. And I mean, I admired him. I admired all the preachers that did that. Mm-hmm. People don't realize that that the church is so essential in our evolvement. You know, I mean, so many of the great leaders, even people who are business people, a lot of them learn their business acumen in church, and everything like that, So I was very, very sad and angry when Dr. Martin Luther King was killed, I just felt like that I was the kind of a person who was 50-50, you know? I mean, I felt that being passive and turn the other cheek, there was, so I would turn the other cheek, but then after that, I didn't have any more cheeks to turn. So yeah. Then, so then now I got to, fight fire with fire, So I would take that approach, to try to be, nonviolent, try to be reasonable, have, some conversation, try to understand the other person's point of view, try mm-hmm. to meet in the middle. And then if it couldn't happen, and somebody was going to get in a fight, I wanted to win.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. And then sometimes winning doesn't mean that you wait for them to hit you first. Sometimes you might have to be on the offensive. So I would say that, being young, that's just kind of way I felt, and being raised out in California, although I was born in the South, mm-hmm. in Arkansas, mm-hmm. being raised in California, we had somewhat of a different experience, because you could talk back, in some places like in Oakland where I grew up, you go to school with people and you felt you were equal or maybe superior, you're playing on the same sports team, you outrun them, you say, I'll run them, maybe I can outthink them too, in the math class or whatever. And so that's just kind of the way my experience was. And so then there was two different philosophies and some philosophies in the middle, and I just kind of blended the two, so I would say my dad was more all the way, you know, Martin. I wasn't all the way Huey Newton and Bobby Seale and H-Rap Brown and people like that, but I was kind of more like in the middle, you know, maybe an homogenized, kind of like chocolate milk, you know, or something like that, you know, just a little chocolate in the milk. Yeah.
I got you. Mm-hmm. I got you. All right. Well, Mr. Williams, thank you so much, man, for joining me again and coming back on. And look, we need to go out and make sure we get his new album. It was released, your single. It came out on the 5th, didn't it?
The 5th of September, right? That's kind of like the technical release date, but more like the 12th of September was when we actually kind of started getting out. But the 5th is the technical date that it was released, yeah.
Okay.
So, kind of getting it up on iTunes and all those various places where people could purchase the record or hear it. Yeah, right.
Uh-huh.
Places, yeah. So it takes a little time for it to matriculate up there.
Right. So
you have an official release date and then a date where you can, you know, really, really get it. Yeah. Yeah.
So everyone, make sure you go out and check it out. It's available on all streaming digital platforms, or you go to LennyWilliams.com. It's on the screen right now. Check it out. And, make sure you go and support our brother, our friend, Mr. Lenny Williams. Thank you so much again, Lenny, for coming on the show and checking us out. And everybody, if you like the show, make sure you click like and you share and you subscribe to the channel, because we always have some great stories of music right here on Les Holmes Stories of Music. Again, Mr. Williams, thank you so much, man.
And okay, I appreciate you.
Anytime. Yes, sir.
All right, sir. Be good now.
Okay, take care.
Adios.